Okay, welcome along. I am chatting about lifestyle changes with Leslie Morrison. Leslie, do you want to just tell us a bit about what you do?
Hi Emily. Yeah, I've been a personal trainer for 13 years. And probably the last 4 or 5 years, I've really kind of focused that sort of health and wellness approach and sort of lifestyle, not changes, but just general lifestyle fitness and well-being to the more sort of specific market of peri to postmenopausal women and hysterectomy recovery women. So it has been a personal journey as well as a professional journey because it's something that I've gone through, and that's obviously what led me down the path. But yeah, so personal training, nutrition coaching, well-being training, pretty much like an umbrella of all of those wellness things,
Perfect.
really.
So you're the prime person to speak to about lifestyle changes.
Absolutely, yes, it's something that I have been talking about for just over a decade now, so.
The reason I put lifestyle changes as our January topic is because it's always a time when people start doing the resolutions and, oh, I must go on a diet. And obviously, we all know that I'm massively anti-diet and all the rest. But I do think that there are little changes that we can all make that will just generally make us feel a bit better.
Absolutely, yeah, you're so spot on. And from when we spoke sort of last year, I think we both came to the conclusion we're both anti-diet. We're both kind of like avoid that calorie restriction, avoid that strict rules of sort of what you can and cannot eat. But there's so many little things that you can do that are so easy and so sustainable long term that, you know, it can really impact not just like from a health perspective. Like putting the personal trainer hat on and going just to general like a, you know, well-being, weight loss, fitness kind of lifestyle, but also in the menopausal sort of scheme of thing, the perimenopause, just little things that you can do to just improve all of those symptoms and the disruption that they have on your day-to-day life. And a lot of them go hand in hand as well, which is really perfect because obviously then you get the benefit of not only having potentially reduced peri-postmenopausal symptoms, but also weight loss, fitness, mental clarity, you know, healthy skin, all of these things. So, I mean, you can kind of look at lifestyle. I tend to look at it as there's four areas of it. So you've got sleep, stress, nutrition, and movement. They're my four main sort of foundational points when I look at lifestyle changes.
And wow, a world in which all four of those is going well is pretty much where we need to be, isn't it?
In the ideal
We're
world,
not in a pandemic, you know.
we're not living in, you know, in the ideal world. Yeah, in the ideal world, those four things are, if they're going well and you know, you're thriving in all four, then you're thriving in life. You know, you're gonna feel pretty good. But there's a kind of like a puzzle, and like, I had a brilliant conversation with someone earlier today where she was talking about all of these different symptoms that she was having from various different ailments and things that she's got going on. But I just said to her one thing. I said, if we just fix one thing at the bottom of the pyramid, everything above it is going to improve. So the best one you can start with, the easiest one you can start with, is actually probably going to be either nutrition or sleep. Because they're the two things that are going to fundamentally screw up your hormones the most. So, you know, it's a big, 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 big topic to cover, and you're never going to talk about all of it in like one session. But certainly, sort of from a nutritional point of food, nutritional point of food, a nutritional perspective, the hormones that you've got in food, how they then affect your, you know, your estrogen and progesterone and testosterone, how they affect your leptin and ghrelin, how they affect your brain function. And I always kind of end up starting people off with gut health, really. It always kind of boils back down to there. But again, sleep is the other one. If you're not having good sleep, your hormones are going to be like chaotic mess, which again, can you look at the menopause? Who in the menopause or perimenopause is having like good sleep consistently?
Absolutely. And it's such a catch 22 as well, isn't it? Because you start getting bad sleep, so your hormones get more disrupted. So you get worse sleep, so your hormones get more disrupted. And it's breaking that cycle, which can be where the movement comes in, the nutrition comes in, addressing stress comes in, and then those can help actually with your sleep. And I totally agree with you, addressing all four of them in different ways, and rather than really fixating on any one, can
yeah, have and it's, a huge difference. It's not productive. It's not productive to try and, like, you know, on a, in an average January as a personal trainer, I would have people coming to me going, oh, I've given up smoking, I've stopped drinking, I've joined the gym, I've done this, I'm doing that. And I'm like, just step back. You're not going to achieve and sustain all of those things one at a time. You know, even if you just have a slightly healthier breakfast today.
Yeah.
Tomorrow you try and have that healthy breakfast again. Screw lunch and dinner. Don't worry about them. Just focus on breakfast. Get breakfast down. Then once you've got that sorted out, maybe try and have a healthy lunch as well. Build up from the bottom and actually kind of do it slowly so you can keep it going. Because we, as humans, we get bored really quickly. Yeah. And we would go for the laziest, most quickest sort of route to get to where we want to go. And if that means starving ourselves, if that's what we think is the right thing to do, that's what we'll do.
And when you look at the stress and sleep side of things, often the quickest and easiest thing is just to grab sugary things, because that gives you that burst of energy. And obviously, again, that's only providing a plaster over the problem, isn't it? It's not actually addressing the underlying thing.
Yeah, and then that, I mean, that was a conversation again I had this morning about insulin resistance and how the body's gonna, you know, if you're constantly, you're gonna get into this perpetual sort of reoccurring cycle of crash, grab sugar, crash, grab sugar, crash, grab sugar. And this particular person I was talking to, she kept saying, you know, I just keep waking up at 3 a.m. every day. 3 a.m., you know, bolt upright, wide awake, not having night sweats or anything like that, but just awake, can't get back to sleep. And then for that following day, obviously all she does is crave carbs, refined sugars, and so on. And I just said to her, just out of curiosity, I said, do you, by chance, you've got quite a stressful job, do you get home from work and have a glass of wine every night? She went, every night. I went, right. Don't have your glass of wine for just for a week. Don't have a glass of wine when you get home from work, and just see if you sleep through, because you're having something that's obviously going to be quite high sugar content later in the day, which means that you're going to crash your sugars around 2 a.m.
Yeah.
And around 3 a.m. your adrenaline's going to spike and wake you up. So I'll be interested to see what she says, because I've had this so many times with other people where I've sort of said, okay, just take away that late night snack, that sweet craving that you're trying to get, because you don't need energy at night. You don't need it when you're home. So just let yourself energy crash. And then if you need to, go to sleep earlier.
Absolutely. And it's really interesting, isn't it, how these lifestyle changes are so small.
Yeah.
They really are tiny. You know,
yeah,
I find it difficult when you know, you see the kind of the guidelines that are out there at large that say, you know, restrict alcohol, cut this back, do this, but without any explanation as to why. And personally, if someone just tells me not to do something, I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
But if someone explains to me why that would be helping me, I'm kind of more inclined to actually do it.
Absolutely. And I think this is largely the problem. You know, again, it comes back to human nature. We are not very good at doing what we're told. And I think we're seeing that quite a lot at the moment. We're not very good at doing what we're told. So to have that rationale, to have that explanation as to, you know, if you sell someone something on the benefit to them, they're more likely to buy into it. Or obviously give them the tools to sort of understand why and let them make that decision for themselves. So I quite often say to all of my clients, you have to weigh up if the pleasure is worth the pain or discomfort.
Exactly. And this is something I'm always talking about with tracking your symptoms, tracking whether food is impacting your symptoms. You know, I know personally, and this breaks my heart because I used to be a wine merchant, but I know that red wine I will feel awful after basically one glass, unless I have it with a very big meal. Now, sometimes the occasion, the meal, everything else justifies, because I want in that minute, in that moment of enjoying the meal, not the moment with my family, whatever, but, you know, and I want that.
Yes.
Because, and I understand that there is a payoff to be had.
Yeah.
But it's an informed choice, isn't it?
Absolutely. And I'm very much the same with dairy products. You know, I absolutely love cheese and milk and yogurt and things like that. But my body does not. It hates it passionately. So if I eat it, I'm normally sort of doubled over on the floor crying with pain, and my stomach's just kind of like squeezing all of its life out of me. But, you know, over Christmas, I sort of sat there and I thought, do you know what? I really want to have a bit of chocolate. I haven't eaten chocolate in years. I really fancy a little bit of chocolate. So I was kind of like, look, I'll tell you what, I'll have a little bit of chocolate, but I'll have it with other things. So the other things kind of mask in a little bit and see what happens. And like, luckily, it wasn't too bad. I didn't feel that bad, but I knew I'd had it. I knew I could feel that I'd had it. But I kind of just accepted that. That was my responsibility, and I accepted that. And I was like, I knew it was going to happen. It was as bad as I thought, but, you know, I wanted it. So I went for it, and there we are. So, yeah, these little changes could be the smallest little thing. It could be not drinking, you know, one cup of coffee a day. So if you have 6 cups of coffee a day or something like that, just have 5 the next day and see if you feel better for it. Or if you have 3 glasses of wine, just have 2. And it could be some, like I said to you earlier, you know, I have a saying with my clients, if you can be 1% better today than you were yesterday, that is a win. Stop putting all the pressure on.
Absolutely. And it's where this whole January, New Year, New You thing sort of seems to assume that you can suddenly be 100% better than you were yesterday, because you can suddenly become a new person because it's January.
Yeah. I actually sent an email out to my mailing list on the 1st of January. It said, new year, same you,
yeah.
Screw it. And it was just like, stop trying to be something different. Be you and be unapologetically you.
Yeah.
But just start making those little, very, very slight changes. And so many times I get emails from women saying, do you know what, I stopped doing this and this has happened and I feel so much better. And I'm like, that great, just fantastic, well done, keep it going.
So if we run through the 4 main pillars, and I know this is a really simplistic thing to ask, right, but do you have just a very simple suggestion for each of the 4?
Yeah, I do. So with nutrition, my biggest tip with nutrition, with anything to do with food, is slow down. So whether that means sit down and chew your food properly rather than just inhaling it like we all do. So actually sit down, sit up straight so your food can transit properly. Chew your food. Whether it means like not buying food on the go for you. Whatever slow down means to you in terms of food, that is my biggest tip with nutrition. It's not about what you put in, it's about how you put it in, where you put it in, like in terms of where you are, not where you put it in your body, but you know, if you're sat in your car or walking down the street or so on. So that's probably my biggest, allow your gut to actually digest your food properly. That will change how you feel dramatically. In terms of sleep, my biggest tip, which I will hold my hands up to say I'm rubbish at this one, but I touch wood, don't get that bad of sleep at the moment, is just reduce the amount of blue light you're getting before bed. So probably about an hour minimum before bed, just try and reduce it. Just sit on your bed and read a book, have a bath, whatever it is, just relax that side of it. And another one, actually, this is the second one for sleep, I would say, I've heard a lot of people talking about heating recently, being cold.
Yeah.
And they're turning their heating up really, really high in their bedroom, thinking that it's really good for you to sleep in a hot room. It's not at all. It's the opposite. You want a cool room so you're comfortable. So turn the heating down a couple of notches in the bedroom will probably help you sleep better. Movement is just probably, again, it comes back to that 1% better. So it doesn't have to be an hour long workout like we were actually saying earlier before we started the actual chat. You don't have to exercise for an hour. And when you do exercise, it doesn't have to be the most intense workout you've ever seen in your life. You do not need to suddenly become like, you know, an insanity type trainer or something like that. It doesn't need to be that. Even if you just start doing yoga or Pilates or body conditioning or just walking in the park, if you haven't been moving up to that point, that is better than you were.
So, absolutely. Yeah. Pop some tunes on, dance around the kitchen.
Oh, absolutely. You know what? I'm always like, I'm tidying my house up. I'm like dancing around with a Hoover. Why not? If it gets you hot and sweaty and you get your breath up, then why not?
Yeah.
Why not? Crack on some tunes and have a boogie. Why not? And in terms of stress, the one that probably comes up the most with people I'm working with and in my Facebook groups is that sometimes doing nothing is good for you. And I actually started teaching restorative yoga last summer, which for me as a personal trainer, having taught things like spin and body pump and boxer size and circuits, doing restorative yoga is a real kind of like, what is this sorcery? Lying on the floor doing nothing and I can call this exercise. This is amazing. So, but it's really good for your nervous system. So obviously if your nervous system is slightly pent up and stressed and overactive, that's not going to help in sleep. It's not going to help in nutrition. It's not going to help anywhere in your lifestyle. So probably in terms of stress management, it is maybe doing nothing is what you need to do. And not all the time, but just actually taking like a half an hour slot where you just lie and do nothing in stillness. Yeah. Get a lavender eye pillow and just pop it over your head and just lay there on the floor. It's blissfully wonderful and highly, highly recommended.
And those are all things that we can, you know, ultimately it is about slowing down, isn't it? Slowing down how you eat, slowing down before you go to sleep. Slowing down your exercise if you've been too frantic, and slowing down life to try and calm the stress down a bit. And yeah. I think perimenopause is a great time for us to, you know, our hormones come along and slap us around the face and basically make us have to sit up and take note. And we might as well listen.
Yeah. And I've actually got a line on my website that says menopause, the time in life where we can actually pause for ourselves. And it's kind of like, you're being given this opportunity. And someone explained it to me as we're kind of like this sandwich generation. So a lot of us have got sort of older parents that we're sort of having to not care for as such, but you know, they're above us and we're worried about them and their health. And then many of us have got children as well. So we've got that below us that we've got to care for. So we've got kind of like this double load of responsibility coming at us. And it doesn't, a lot of women won't actually allow themselves the time to take for themselves. They kind of go, oh, I feel selfish if I take half an hour for myself. No, do you know what? Looking after yourself, self-care is the least selfish thing you can do right now. Because if you're unwell or weak, or, you know, you can't function properly because of whatever's going on in your life, those people above and below you in your sort of care cycle, they're not going to have you to look after them when they need you, because you're not making time for yourself. So although you see it as a selfish thing to do, it is ultimately for you, but it's for them as well.
Absolutely. So, and it's that whole airplane thing of put your own oxygen mask on first. You've got to put yourself first to be able to help anybody else, haven't you?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And it is... I think like with the exercise side of things, and there's a lot of like with perimenopause, with menopause, with postmenopause, there's a lot of myths and misinformation about what you, I know that look, There's a lot of it out there, and women are unfortunately being kind of just, they're being served with like a huge disservice in terms of what they're doing for their body. And there are changes that we need to make in terms of what we're doing. There are different ways we can exercise. You know, it's not to say that once we hit this stage in our life, we have to suddenly stop doing everything we did before. But there are things that we can do in terms of like movement and nutrition and things like that, that are just going to help all of those areas a little bit more as well. Certainly post, like, you know, going into the postmenopause, when you're looking at things like osteoporosis and bone health and brain health and all of that stuff, there are things that we can do now in perimenopause that will help us combat that in postmenopause. But if we leave it too late, we're always playing catch up. So I always say to my clients, you know, you're better off, even if you're not feeling it that badly yet, start now, because then when you get there and you're in that boat, it won't be as bad.
This is something, honestly, anybody who comes to any of my fitness classes will be like going, oh God, she does this. I incorporate balance into every single class I ever teach, particularly when it's with women, but actually with men as well, because, you know, as women, we are all at risk of osteoporosis as we get older. Now, if our balance is good, even if our bones are brittle, we're more likely to stay upright in the first place. I know that's very simplistic, but it's one of those little things that, you know, I and as I say, anybody watching this who's ever come to any of my fitness classes will be like, oh God, she does, it's so boring. But stand on one leg while you brush your teeth.
Why not? Why not? I've started doing it with, I'm actually starting, it's not going yet, but I'm actually starting like a menopause specific movement class. And that has a sort of a portion of it, which very similar to what you're saying with the balance and having the ability and stability to not fall. It actually goes into a slightly sort of, if people were coming, they'd be like, what the heck are we doing this for? But like a cognitive workout. So it's that coordination, catching a ball. And they're like, why are we doing this? I'm like, well, do you believe me? If I tell you, you can catch a ball and you can juggle, or you can throw a ball and catch it, or anything like that, you're less likely to have cognitive impairment later on.
Yeah.
And also that coordination, same thing as the stability. If you're coordinated and you've got that mental sort of mind, body to mind kind of coordination going on, you're less likely to trip over. And if you do trip over, you're more likely to save it and not face plant and do yourself a really bad mischief. 75% of hip fractures that happen in the world happen to women.
Yeah.
And that's crazy.
Yeah.
And I think it's the third fracture before anyone really gets the osteoporotic diagnosis. So if we can kind of reduce those hip fractures and things like that. I've got loads of clients who come to, when we were doing face-to-face Pilates classes, loads of the ladies that came to my class were hip injuries, hip replacements, hip fractures. And you just think, I'm not going down this bloody road. I'm not going to be one of these women that can't lift my leg off the floor, let alone sort of get myself up and down off the floor. I want to be one of those women that can still move when I'm in my 60s and 70s. Thank you very much.
Absolutely. And it's all about, as we say, these little lifestyle changes now puts us in good stead for all of that.
Yeah. What you do in your, I mean, what, your 40s into your 50s, even your late 30s, what you do during that, it's almost, look at it like childhood, you know, what you do in your formative years. Look at it again in the same way. Look at what you do in your formative years now to then make that time much more enjoyable. And, you know, it's absolutely possible to thrive through your menopause, perimenopause through to postmenopause, absolutely possible. A lot of it is mindset. But if you put in the work, you can. You can. I had someone say to me the other day, they said, "You're too young to understand menopause." I was like, "I had a hysterectomy 2 years ago," and they were like, "Oh."
So I get it, right?
Like, yeah, I woke up in menopause. I didn't get that gradual decline. I just went bang straight into it. Hello, hot flushes, brain fog. What is this? So it's kind of that there is different aspects to menopause. There is different reasons for going into menopause, different ages. But if you can improve your stress management and improve your cortisol production, you're going to improve your progesterone production, which is going to change and reduce the fact that you may be having estrogen dominance. If you then look at your nutrition and the phytoestrogens and the food, like the pack, even the packaging that food comes in can have hormone disruptors within it. Look at that from a, you know, it's when you, again, you come back to that nutrition, movement, stress, sleep, the four key pillars of feeling good, whether it's for weight loss or reducing your hot flushes, it's the same four things.
Awesome.
That's my bit on it.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.